Forget about
70% and 80%.
70%, 80%.
70% and 80%.
70% and 80%.
80% vaccine coverage is now the only number that matters.
Between 70% and 80%, we did see that there was the opportunity for cases to grow more rapidly in that window. The ultimate size of the epidemic was bigger.
The original Doherty modelling based its projections on low daily case rates under 100, but the new modelling looks at low, medium and high seeding scenarios.
At the time that the Doherty work was done, it was very clear that Delta spread more quickly, and it's now far more clear that Delta is more severe, and so forecasts of potential hospitalisations would account for the increased severity of Delta.
In the medium and high scenarios, similar to Victoria and New South Wales, all but a modest loosening of restrictions before 80% coverage could jeopardise our test, trace, isolate and quarantine capability, or TTIQ, and that could jeopardise everything.
Delta is really hard.
Amid criticism of the Victorian roadmap, this new modelling reinforces the need for caution.
The immediate response has been really despondency. People were hoping for much bigger steps forward, and these have really been baby steps.
They're perfectly entitled to their different views, but if you pretend that you've got an alternative plan, well, then please provide me with the modelling, the detailed modelling that backs that up.
And as lockdown fatigue rolls on, a timely reminder of just how high the stakes are if we get this wrong.
So what we're casually discussing is an increase in deaths of our fellow citizens. Now, it appears the community are comfortable with that, but in my experience, everybody is very comfortable when there's somebody else who's dying. They're much less comfortable when somebody they know or is a member of their family, and they're really annoyed when it's them.
Professor Jodie McVernon is a Doherty Institute epidemiologist and joins us now. Jodie, given the new modelling, how do you assess the reopening plans for Victoria and New South Wales?
So I think those plans are both concordant with the national plan and obviously go into further detail based on what's actually happening in each of those jurisdictions. And, you know, as our modelling shows, vaccination, as it gets to higher coverage levels, will do more of the heavy lifting of controlling COVID-19. But we're still going to need to balance that with other social measures and public health responses to be able to prevent case numbers from rising. So all of those are really very concordant.
I suppose the question is that whether or not they've gone maybe too far or not far enough with some of the restrictions, particularly once we hit 70%, and we as the public were dealing with the old modelling which you've since updated, do you think that their plans are good plans, that they actually are in line with the modelling that you're suggesting?
Look, they are. And when we talk about public health and social measures in the model, we're talking about what we've observed sets of restrictions have been able to achieve. So we're not saying these are the specific actions that any jurisdiction should take. And obviously, as states look to ease their restrictions, they're trying to find the least risky way to do so to prevent infections escalating. And there's going to be ongoing monitoring of what happens with the epidemic, which will allow them to keep adjusting their measures.
So, Professor, we had the New South Wales Premier Gladys Berejiklian today suggesting we stop concentrating on case numbers and shift our attention to hospitalisation and the death rate. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in this era of, you know, zero COVID, obviously every infection has mattered and we've been wanting to stamp every last one out because we've been worried it would get away from us. But as we're moving into this new era, we have vaccines to help control spread, but also to reduce the severe disease. You know, at that point, it's really, is our health system coping? And so understanding how that's tracking and how severe infections are going is going to have to be our new focus.
What's interesting is that we'd been told, and I think Doherty had confirmed, that the starting point for the number of cases didn't really affect the overall modelling. Clearly, you've changed your view on that because you've rerun the model. Is there something about the real-world data that has led you to do that?
So we set up scenarios to a question. We were asked whether that would be sensitive to assumptions, and we found that in almost, or for the 80% scenarios and for the low and medium seeding 70% scenarios, our conclusions were robust. So we found the point where the system broke, and that was important because that let us provide updated advice. And if the conditions change, you change the model, you provide updated advice. This kind of adaptive decision-making is what we've been doing throughout the pandemic.
Do you get annoyed about the politicisation of the modelling?
I think as academics advising policy, we understand that that's a risk.
Very.
Wow, that's diplomatic.
A very political, diplomatic answer there.
Yeah.
And I think it's a yes as well.
Yeah, you understand the risk. Does it annoy you?
Oh, it's not really relevant. You know, we do the work because we believe it's important. And that's why we're here.
You're right, Liz. That is absolutely a yes.
Yeah.
Are you ready?
And
yes?
You're actually starting to sound like a politician yourself, Professor. I just want to warn you.
I'm not looking for a career change, but thanks.
Professor, thank you very much for your time tonight.
Thanks, Ollie. Thanks, Ollie.
From expert opinions to in-depth analysis and reporting, the Project YouTube brings you the biggest stories from Australia and around the globe. Hit the subscribe button now for news delivered straight to your feed.